So, Daniel, you were sharing some things with us at the camp meeting about the books of Daniel and Revelation that were just profound. It really made the books easy to understand, and I really would love it if you could share with everyone what the information you're sharing with us.
Well, I was asked to share a little bit about some, you know, Daniel and Revelation in very short, like 2 or 3 minute segments, and I think it's quite interesting with when you look at the book of Daniel, and you see that the first chapters, 1 through 6, actually go in chronological order in sync with the three angels' messages of Revelation 14, verses 6 through 12.
I had never heard that before. Seriously.
Yeah, so the first chapter of Daniel, you see that Daniel fears God and he gives glory to him. So whatsoever he drinks, whatsoever he does, and whatsoever he eats, he does all to the glory of God, like it says in 1 Corinthians 10:31.
Right.
So that's the idea pictured in a real-life story in Daniel chapter 1. Well, the next chapter, in chapter 2, is that the king is upset and he's committed judgment against anybody who is not following his own command, which is, of course, you know, revealing the dream and the interpretation.
Right.
And so now the hour of his judgment had come.
Mm.
And it's interesting that even in that segment, when after the hour of his judgment had come, God gave to his prophet the gift of the testimony of Jesus, or the spirit of prophecy, because then they were praying for the God of heaven to reveal the dream, and the spirit of prophecy was given during that time of the judgment hour, right?
Mm.
So Daniel chapter 1, fear God and give glory to him. Chapter 2, the hour of his judgment has come. Chapter 3, worship him that made. Don't worship that which man made, like this image that,
gold,
you know,
statue,
right, exactly. So the call is to follow and worship God and fear him, worship him. That's like the first, second, and third part of the first angel's message, which is at chapter 1, 2, and 3 of the book of Daniel. Then you have chapter 4 of the book of Daniel where Babylon is fallen.
Right.
And that's the first time it's said, but there's a second time it's said, is fallen because of the wine, because she made all nations drink of the wine. In Daniel chapter 4, you have Nebuchadnezzar taking what, or having what you, what we call the lycanthropic insanity. And he actually thinks he's an animal. You can look it up. It's a real disease where people think that they're animals. Well, he lives as a vegan vegetarian for 7 years, and the Lord straightens out his mind.
Right.
And so that's the fall of Babylon. But what's interesting about that is the deadly wound was healed because he was put back on the throne with the same amount of power, which is kind of interesting when you're looking at Revelation 13. Isn't it amazing?
Yeah.
So then you have, that's chapter 4. Then chapter 5 is where is fallen the second time because she made all nations drink of the wine. And what happened there is Belshazzar, the leader of Babylon, has called all the lords and princes and kings and captains to come and drink wine, Babylonian wine, out of the vessels, the holy vessels of God in the sanctuary, treating holy things as though they're common.
Right.
Chapter 6 is actually the third angel's message, and it includes justification by faith in verity as well.
How's this?
Well, this is really quite complex, and I have messages on these things as well that go a little bit deeper. But if you think about Daniel chapter 6, what you have is the minority, which is Daniel, and he is obedient to the commandments of God through the faith of his son, Jesus Christ.
Right.
And we know that the Son of God is mentioned in the book of Daniel already.
Exactly.
But the majority is against this minority. The majority is an ecumenical movement. They're all coming together, thinking and showing as though they have unity, which is not really true. Because they said all the captains and princes have gathered together. Well, that wasn't true because Daniel wasn't involved.
Right.
So they have a false unity, and that's what makes up their ecumenical movement. It's a false unity, and what they're trying to do is establish laws that are void of religious liberty, and it's for the whole world. And what they're trying to do is take the same thing that happened in the abomination of desolation scenario of the 1260 years.
Right.
They're taking the focus from heaven down to the earth. And so they're saying that everybody has to worship this one man at the head of this whole ecumenical movement, right, that's worldwide. And what's interesting as well about that is that they're claiming that whatever laws Medo-Persia establishes, they are laws that cannot be changed. You know what that is?
Right.
It's a claim to infallibility.
Exactly, yeah.
Exactly. And so this whole movement claims infallibility. There's one man at the head. You're going to worship the this system according to the dictates of their conscience, or else you will be
mercy.
Persecution against the minority, which you're trying to keep the commandments of God. And Daniel, of course, he was a Bible student, he was praying, and he was witnessing as well. You can see that in the text. And that's what caused him to be able to say to the king, innocency was found before me. And then he was delivered because he believed.
Justification by faith.
Exactly. He was innocent because he believed. Amen. Just what you said. So this whole thing is the third angel's message. Now, I'm taking a little bit longer than I did before, but if you don't mind, we have Daniel chapter 7 goes three times through this idea of little horn, judgment, and kingdom.
Okay.
Little horn, judgment, and kingdom. And you can say it with me. Little horn, judgment, and kingdom.
Okay.
So that's three times in that order in Daniel chapter 7. Chapter 8 deals with the little horn. Chapter 9 and 10 deal with the judgment, because we have the judgment of this world when Christ came, when it's explained in Daniel chapter 9 that he came in the midst of the week. Mm-hmm. And then you see in chapter 10 that there's a judgment on the Medo-Persian kingdom, right?
Right, so you have this
judgment going on there. And also, we know that 1844 is a judgment for the whole world. So all of that's pictured there in Daniel chapter 9 and also chapter 10. Well, then chapter 11 and 12 deal with the kingdom. So what do you have in chapters 7 through 12? The little horn, judgment, and kingdom.
Right.
Wow. So that's the book of Daniel in a quick summation. Let me talk about the book of Revelation real quick.
Now, this is a complex book.
This is huge. But the first half of it is really simple. In chapter 1, you've got a picture of Christ. Right, he's in the midst of the candlesticks, followed by seven churches. Then you have in chapter 5, there's the Lamb of God as though he had been slain, which is a picture of Christ, followed by seven seals. Then you have in chapter 8, there's Christ who is offering the incense, and then there's seven trumpets.
Right?
So you've just seen Christ, seven churches, Christ, seven seals, Christ, seven trumpets.
Right.
That is chapters 1 through 11.
Watch.
Okay, that's huge.
That is the fastest I've ever gone through that.
But see, the point is, like, you've got six churches, and then there's a different one with the seventh.
Right.
From the sixth church comes the 144,000, but the seventh church is the only one mentioned that doesn't have Christ in it. He's outside knocking on the door, trying to get in. So you have, like, six and then the seventh. But there's the 144,000 right there.
Right.
In the seals, you have six, which is, there's an interlude with chapter 7, which includes the 144,000. And then there's chapter 8, finishing the final seal. In the trumpets, you have six of them with an interlude of chapters 10 and 11, where chapter 10 is dealing with who the 144,000 are.
Right.
And then you have the seventh trumpet coming in chapter 11 at the end. So you have six, the 144,000, the seventh. Six, the 144,000, the seventh. Six, the 144,000, the seventh.
Yeah, because we're in between the sixth and the seventh right now, right?
Right, exactly. And so what you can see, and that's where God has already been raising up the 144,000 since the 1840s.
Right.
But see, what you have there is the first half is just three kind of like roads of history. One, you know, ecclesiastical or church history. And then you have one that's dealing with like state history or civil history, and then you have war history that's going on in the trumpets. And what you've seen is from the time that Christ was on the earth until the second coming in the churches, from the time of Christ was on the earth till the second coming in the seals, from the time Christ was on the earth until the second coming in the trumpets. So it's really just three histories, and you can see six interlude seven.
Right.
That's the first half. Well, chapters 12 through 16 go over that same history. Remember that baby that was in the woman in chapter 12?
Right.
That's Christ on the earth.
Amen.
The first time, right, when he came? Well, chapter 16 leads you through all the seven last plagues right before Christ comes. And so you have that same history, but what you're dealing with are some of the kingdoms of this world that are trying to bring in the false, could you say Trinity? Because you have the dragon, you have the beast, and you have the false prophet. A false father, a false son, and a false Holy Spirit.
You know, I've actually heard people say that's a reason why they believe in the real Trinity, because if there's a false one, there has to be a true one.
Well, you know, the false one was including the third being in the councils of God.
Right.
And the true one didn't have a third being in the councils of God. See, Lucifer wanted to be in that council where it says in Zechariah chapter 6, verse 12, that, you know, there was the council between them both.
Right.
Well, Lucifer wanted to be in there. He couldn't be. So he set up his own kingdom on the earth to try to mimic what he wanted. That's where it's coming from.
Right.
You see
that
how
makes
it works?
Sense.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then you have this false trinity there in the midst of chapters 12 and 16. But then in response to those three, the three, actually in chapter 16 as well, there's three angels that the enemy has. There's three demons that go to the kings of the earth.
Okay.
Well, God in chapter 14 has three angels as well.
That's right.
The first, second, and the third angel's message. And so there's these war between the angels and the messages of truth and error. Mm. And then you have chapter 15 where there's the, you know, the close of probation and the plagues come out.
Right.
But that really is, again, the history of Christ the first time till the Christ the second time. Now, 17 through 22 is
right.
kind of like a chronological end time scenario.
Right.
I'll just try to make it simple. Chapter 17 is Babylon described. Babylon is going to be certainly alive and well at the end of time. Then you have Babylon destroyed in chapter 18.
Okay.
The second coming in chapter 19.
Right, because he has a sword in his mouth.
Right, and he comes with all his armies and he's on this white horse. That's all pictured there in 19. You have the 1,000 years after the coming of Christ in chapter 20.
Right.
You have the holy city coming down after the 1,000 years in 21. And then you have God with his people, with Christ and all the angels living throughout the ceaseless ages of eternity.
Wow.
That's the pictures of Daniel and Revelation, just summed up real quick.
Was that 5 minutes?
I have no idea, but that's it's so fun to be able to look at that and just be able to see those books from not necessarily all the trees in the forest, but to look back
right.
and see the forest at the same time and
well,
say, wow.
Praise God, man.
Yeah.
And if you want more information, I believe it's revelationwithdaniel.com.
That's right, yep.
Revelationwithdaniel.com, and you get to hear all that from Daniel Mesa in even more depth. But we hope you enjoy. And we'll see you next time.
Praise the Lord.